Welcome to Webber Wentzel. I know for some of you, it's been quite a journey. Level 4 load shedding and 1.5 hours to get from four ways to our office in Sandton must have been a challenge. But a warm welcome to all of you, especially I think to our riveting workshop on the implications of a potential greylisting. By way of introduction, my name is Priyesh Daya. I am a partner and the head of the dispute resolution unit at Webber Wentzel. And we focus a lot on the business crimes and anti-corruption offering as well. I think it would be remiss of me not to mention that we have to talk about greylisting against the backdrop of corruption as well in our country. We are all painfully aware of the scourge of corruption, which has been plaguing our country for many years. We all followed the state capture proceedings and studied the commission's report. We wait patiently for the investigation, prosecution of matters and suspects identified. We are hopeful that the recent government and legislative interventions will militate against our country being greylisted. By now, everybody in this room is aware about the fact that we potentially could be greylisted by the Financial Action Task Force. In recent months, this issue has received considerable attention, media attention, and you know, our president spoke recently as well. So this morning, all of you represent multinational organizations that operate in the international arena and deal with foreign counterparts. As such, you and your organizations would be suitably concerned about South Africa's potential greylisting and all the possible implications for our country and economy. The unfortunate reality is that our greylisting could inevitably impact on our operations and influence the way business is conducted, both within South Africa and internationally. However, instead of adopting a defeatist approach, we would rather like to tell you about, you know, instead of telling you about negative consequences about the greylisting, you know, we have thought it rather best to provide you with an insight into the issue and valuable information that will help guide your organizations through this period of uncertainty. Our keynote speaker today is the Special Director of the Investigating Directorate within the National Prosecuting Authority. Advocate Andrea Johnson has been part of the NPA for 25 years and has prosecuted various high-profile matters, including the corruption case against former National Police Commissioner Jackie Selebi, the late Jackie Selebi, and the much-publicized murder of Riva Steenkamp by former Olympian Oscar Pistorius. I'm just happy to let you all know that I know Andrea. She's a street fighter. We both started practicing in Germiston, in the East Rand. So you're dealing with somebody who's as tough as nails. Andrea was the national head of organized crime at the NPA and recently also the special director of the NPA's terrorism unit. On 1 March 2022, she was appointed by the president to head up the investigating directorate into matters relating to state capture, which the president recently informed would be made a permanent institution to assist in the fight against corruption. Advocate Johnson will be providing us with valuable insight into the NPA's progress and efforts in combating, investigating, and successfully prosecuting business crimes, in particular those relating to state institutions. It's my absolute pleasure to welcome Advocate Johnson to the podium to share her wealth of knowledge and experience with us. Advocate, the floor is yours.
I think my biggest fear this morning was not all of you. It was whether all of you would be able to see all of short me. So I am truly grateful that we have a podium that is user-friendly. So good morning. Thank you that you grace us with your presence. I'm going to try and give you the benefit of my 25, 26 years of wisdom, of having been a true prosecutor. I was never an office advocate. I am really a street fighter. I used to get down and dirty with the best of counsel. I now have the reputation of, if you walk into a courtroom, I love the expression on their faces, and you literally see and hear them say, and forgive me, oh shit, it's her. I'm hoping that's going to take us out of a lot of the issues we have. But as I've been introduced, I am the investigating director. It is not a glorified position. It is perhaps one of the toughest jobs in the country right now. It is one of those jobs, however, that gives me absolute pleasure. After 25, 26 years of prosecuting all kinds of crime, I think I currently am best suited for what the ID needs. And so what the ID needs is someone who is able to walk in, who is able to guide and direct investigations and prosecutions, who is able to give strategic guidance, but who is also operationally savvy. It is very important that when we're fighting state capture and when we deal with the issues of greylisting, you need someone who has the full ambit of the law. So I prosecuted just about everything. And being the national head of organized crime means I really was street fighting with cash in transit, kidnappings, gangsterism, drugs, and in my last 4 or 5 months with terrorism issues. All of those issues have an impact on the greylisting, and we'll talk about them. Because the greylisting talks to money laundering. It also talks to whether or not we have the ability to counter terror financing. Do we know what terror financing is? And do we know what money laundering is? So I'm not sure who all of you are in the room, but I'm hoping that today you have the ability to appreciate and understand that the fight against the greylisting is a collective responsibility. It is not just the responsibility of law enforcement. So ask yourself when you leave, even if I haven't given you pearls of wisdom, if you're in the space that requires us to change, do you have what it takes to change? So I was given a few questions. Apparently I'm supposed to tell you about my highlights in the ID, and I'm going to tell you what it feels like to be the head of the Investigating Directorate. I'm proud to be in a space that makes a visible and a palpable difference, because the difference we make is a difference not just to high-end executives. It's not just to high corporates and higher positions in government. What we do changes everyday life. If we deal with state capture, it means the people we serve actually get to have the service they should have got had we not had state capture. It's going to be slow. But people are entitled, as they are through the Constitution, to education, water. They're entitled to their human rights. They're entitled to have housing. They're entitled to have service delivery. And unfortunately, state capture robbed them of that. And if all we do as the ID is make an impact in everyday life, then we would have done our job. I think for me, it is important that in the ID, we get to deal with our work on an urgent, expedited basis. We must be able to see the bigger picture. We must be able to apply the strategy and operationalize that which we have to do. I think people are tired in South Africa of waiting. I think the woe is me time is way up. I'd just like to remind you all that I only took office from the 1st of March, 2022. But I have to say that the difference is seen, heard, and felt. And it's not just because of me. We have a dedicated team, a multidisciplinary team. Unfortunately, we have a borrowed team. We actually are only 7 permanent members of the ID of a staff contingent of 115. We borrow. So we borrow from the DPCI, which are the Hawks. We borrowed from IPED, those investigators. And we have prosecutors from the NPA who are on what they call secondment or duty reassignment. We have financial investigators on contract, and we have data analysts on contract. But that will change. And that changes because the president, in his wisdom, when he appointed me, also decided to be wise and declare us permanent on the 23rd of October. And the reason for that permanence is we gave him reason to make us permanent. In the 6 months from 1 March up until the end of September, we enrolled 9 seminal cases. 2 of those major cases, or let's say 3, Cindy, the 54 million rand fraud and corruption by high-ranking members of SEPs. And unfortunately for me, those are the people who do my vetting. They know where I live, but it's okay, they're now on the court roll. We had Transnet, we had Eskom, and that is no easy task. But it is a task made possible that despite having borrowed people, contract individuals. It was the ability to appreciate and understand the vision that the ID has. It is the ability of making people understand the necessity of this journey. It is a difficult journey. It is a dangerous journey, but it is an extremely fulfilling one. So you will find the passion I voice today is the passion I've had all of my 25, 26 years in my career. And it is the passion that I was hoping to instill, and I think I have, in the ID staff, and that is spoken for in terms of the work that we deliver. I love going to, so my media liaison and spokesperson seated in the front, Cindy Siwetwala, we have constant arguments. I hate media engagements. I really don't like it. I know I shock you because I've got gift of the gab, trust me. But I don't like them. I like these engagements. And I like them because I am hoping I get to talk to like-minded people who carry the passion forward to do what is right on any given day. And I think doing what is right is important. It's important when you don't have to ask what is the right thing to do. It should become automatic. And so I had an engagement about a month or two ago. And when I was going back to my car, members of the public, it was Ferial Hafiji's book launch. So members of the public who were going back to their car, an elderly couple stopped their car, and the female passenger opened her window. She put her hands together like this, and she said, "Thank you for giving us hope." And I was absolutely flabbergasted because I didn't know that that is what people saw what I was doing as the head of the ID and what the ID was doing. And so if that's all we do, then we're doing something right. Because if I can give hope in 6 months, now that the president has deemed us permanent, and now that we have an established vacancy, and now that the Minister of Justice on Tuesday gave us our policing peace powers, means that I now get to effectively utilize those people in my space. It means that we get to advertise our positions. It means that I'm now able to recruit a capacity that we hope to retain. I'm hoping that we attract and retain people with passion, drive, commitment, and a love for our citizenry. Because if you don't have it, you don't belong in the ID. It is passion for the job that's going to make you want to do the job. It is also important, I think, that we understand that the ravages of state capture have impacted on the grey listing and where we stand. I'm going to get to that in a moment. I think it is also important that we understand that whilst the ID has been declared permanent, we are not yet legislatively permanent. So I think by the time everyone does their dotting I's and crossing T's and legislation does what it does, we should then have that permanent power and force come April. And we're hoping that we are able to change the game. One thing we're not going to do, Cindy, is, unlike when I was in the Scorpions, we're not driving around in marked cars, blaring sirens. I think I made it clear, when we come for you, you're not going to see me coming. We're not going to be knocking on your door. We're going to get there. We're going to get you. We're going to get to court. We're going to do our business. We're going to do it professionally. And we're going to give the country the results it is supposed to get. I was also asked to touch on what inroads the ID and the NPA have made towards investigating and prosecuting state capture matters. I've said that in the past 6 months, we enrolled 9 seminal matters. The ID was proclaimed on the 4th of April, 2019. To date, it has enrolled 89 cases, with 165 accused on the court roll, and with over 5 billion assets either restrained or froze. It's not in the fridge. I still don't get the froze thing and the preserved thing, but that's the asset forfeiture language. Is it enough? No, it isn't. But we must be proud of what we've been able to do in the time we've been able to do it, borrowed stuff and all. And that is something that we should call an achievement. And when I look at how we deal now with collaboration, law enforcement does not like to collaborate. Law enforcement keeps secrets. We've been able to collaborate. There is far more higher levels of stakeholder engagement than there ever was. We collaborate with the DPCI. We collaborate in terms of public-private partnerships. We have had engagements with BLSA, with BUSA, quite a few other organizations and institutions. And the private sector says, we are here. What would you like us to do? And so, as a country, the ID as an institution realizes that we won't be able as law enforcement to deal with state capture cases all by ourselves. So public-private partnerships and collaborations are key. And as a result, we have lots of matters on the court roll. I just want to make one point, is that it's not only the ID who deals with state capture cases. We have the DPCI, that is the Hawks, and the NPA has a specialized commercial crimes unit that also deals with commercial matters, and they then deal with the balance of the matters. And so we deal with those high levels of corruption, and the rest of it in terms of state capture in the main is dealt with by the different agencies. I think what is important about collaboration is we've been able to sit for the first time in a long time and talk about how we divvy up the work, how we apply our strategy, how we decide who goes first, how we decide if on a specific week the DPCI wanted to go on a takedown in terms of arrest, search, and seizures. But the ID also wanted to do that. Previously, people didn't talk or hardly talked. And so you would find there was no coordination. So now we're smart. We work out a roster. They go on Monday. We're going on Tuesday. Everybody thinks, Bob's your uncle, that's enough for this week. Oh, no, we're coming on Thursday, and the Hawks come on Friday. And so we've learned in terms of operations to show impact by being more visible, because that is what our people want. Our people want to see us do the work. They don't want to hear us jabber about what we think we can do. They want to see us actually do the work. So we have a lot more collaboration. In terms of what the private sector can do to assist in law enforcement, first of all, the private sector, and you will forgive me, I will say it straight off the cuff, I can be blunt, because my bluntness is honest. And if you can't live your truth, and you can't have introspection, oh, you will fail, even if you're the private sector, in luxurious buildings with a lot of incentives for your employees over and beyond their salaries and beautiful working environments. So before the public, private sector can help the public sector, have you had your come to Jesus moment? Have you looked at the Zondo report? Have you looked at the Paul Holden report? Do you realize how very complicit you were in state capture? Do you realize that you put together teams to capture the state? You came with a strategy. You are multinational companies who have a lot of money to put together these strategies. You came in deliberately, and we should never forget that. And so you deliberately exploited what you knew is a weakness. So of course, the public sector and government officials do have a weakness. You saw it, you exploited it. What do you do about it? Are you going to correct it? Or are you going to say, oh, okay, well, what's done is done, but how do I help you? I'm not going to take your help. I refuse. So there are entities who have come to us to offer their help, and I'm very sorry we're not going to accept it. Because if you haven't gone back, if you haven't looked at your corporate governance, you haven't looked at your compliance, you haven't looked at your shortcomings, please don't come and offer us help. Law enforcement is good. We'll get there when we get there. But the help that you give must be because you understand the ravages of what the private sector did in cahoots with the public sector. We didn't do it by ourselves. We did it with you. In fact, a lot of the private sector came, I'm here. This is my business. These are the benefits you'll get if you give me your business. And so you need to go back, and you've got to look at Zondo. Because I think the challenge I have is that everyone asks, what's law enforcement going to do? What's government going to do? What's parliament going to do? So what are you going to do? You got billion-dollar contracts, private sector. You live large. The bribes you paid to government officials are a tip of the iceberg of the money that you corruptly and unlawfully and ever so intentionally derived from your relationship. So the Paul Holden report, as captured in Zondo, correctly identifies, and this is where the greylisting and the criminal laws amendment and the omnibus bill becomes relevant. The judge said, attorneys, the banks, consultants, trustees, complicit. And the ID is looking at you as enablers. So we're coming for those enablers. And we're coming for those enablers because the question to be asked is, but for your willful conduct, banks have a duty to report. Where are those STRs? What is more important? Clientele, good corporate governance. Why wasn't it like this? You have to ask attorneys, do you care where the money comes from, which your clients pay to you? Does it matter? Should it matter? Of course it should matter. And young up-and-coming attorneys in this room, principle always. So listen, I'm a girl's girl. Cindy will tell you, I love handbags and shoes. But I work for government. So I can see a handbag today. I'm one of those smarty ones that will watch it online. And maybe in a month and a half, 2 months from now, it's 35% marked off. Girls got a handbag the right way. And I waited patiently. Sometimes these jobs look beautiful because it looks like the perks are good. You have to understand your legal obligations and your moral obligations. So it becomes very important for up-and-coming legal practitioners to go and read the Paul Holden report and see how very important it is for you to understand where the money you get comes from. We enrolled an attorney 3 weeks ago in the ESCOM matter. 3 years ago, I was the deputy director overseeing the VBS matter. Much to my horror, we had to charge a partner of KPMG. And I was horrified for a few reasons. Way back in my younger day, well, very much younger day, when I was at the Scorpions, we worked with these auditing firms. We looked up to these auditing firms. We never had reason to question their integrity and or their ability. So it pained me when the day came and we had to make a decision about prosecuting a very senior partner of a very high and well-renowned auditing firm. So forensic work is critical to our work, but similarly to the attorneys and legal practitioners, your integrity is paramount. I should tell you what greylisting means for South Africa. And I don't even think I really want to, because I don't want us to get there. I think we've worked hard. Now, you may not know the work we've done. Since I took office, we've had to engage with the process of preparing our reports for FATF. I dare say, it's an impressive report. FATF may not think so, but as a country, we've done a lot of work. We have prosecuted a lot of money laundering cases. We have a lot of money laundering cases currently enrolled. We have used across the NPA a lot of legal instruments in terms of the MLAs and our extradition applications. We do this together with investigative authorities. We've used a lot of the intelligence reports. Can we do better? I'm sure someone's going to tell us yes. But in terms of what we have been able to do, and I think people forget, for almost 2 full years, we had COVID. So quite frankly, we shouldn't have the targets we have. We shouldn't have the output we have. So if we are supposed to be greylisted, I think the question to be asked as a country is, what are the requirements? Where's the reality of FATF? Do they understand who we are as a country? Do they appreciate the challenges we have faced? And despite that, we are able to give them the kind of report that we give them. So the only two aspects that they might clap us on is terror financing, because we haven't prosecuted terror financing matters, although we have enrolled one or two terror financing matters. But if I had to meet the inspectors, I would ask them to kindly consider that after their visit in 2019, as a country, we reviewed the national counterterrorism strategy, and we actually inserted for the first time an entire pillar only to deal with terror financing. That's called progress. That's called listening to the deficiency and seeing how it can be rectified. We have upped our game in terms of enrolling money laundering matters, and we've made sure that prosecutors understand that you've got to look for the money laundering matters. I think the challenge has been people think that money laundering only happens in financial crimes. It doesn't. It happens across the board in terms of financial crimes or forms of organized crime and our terror financing. Maybe the legislation in terms of the General Laws Amendment, which is still our bill, should have been enacted sooner. But we have had challenges. People forget, South Africa is a democracy. Public consultation is important. It takes time. We had COVID for 2 years. We're stuck and confined to our homes. How do you do this public consultation process? And at the stage we were able to do it as a country, the Department of Treasury embarked on it. Of course, FATF's going to say, okay, thank you, it's a little late. But we've got to be able to say we did what we were told to do as best we could in the time that we were given. We are still a new democracy. We actually have really good laws. We have good regulations. Perhaps our biggest fault, which is what we try to rectify, is true collaboration, true coordination, and that will come. It has started, but it is an ability and an appreciation to understand that the greylisting, the FATF, is a country responsibility. So no one party can take responsibility. We all have to bring our A game, and of course we'll get there. Mauritius, we had been talking about them, and I did say we sort of discussed them yesterday, and they've given us hope. So small as you might be, you did give us hope, Mauritius, because worst case scenario, if we do get greylisted, I'm not going to tell you that we're going to get greylisted. I've seen our work. It's a 50-50. So if we get greylisted, then we say, what's the hard work we've got to do? How fast must we do it? Mauritius came out of it in 2 years. Whether they came out of it by themselves or with help, the point is they got out of it. There are countries that hide their greylisting. We got cooperation recently from Dubai on the Gupta matter, and we realized that they had been greylisted. We didn't know they were greylisted. And so countries will come to the fore and assist us now more than before. Of course, we're going to exploit it. Because, hey, I've got business, I've got work, I want your people. I want them here and I want them to face prosecution. But the greylisting should not give us a sense of hopelessness. So I heard the intro. Of course it will change our game. But it changes it only insofar as we allow it to change us. So you have to ask, so what must stop us from doing what we were doing? The only thing is we may have to do it faster and differently. And we shouldn't see a potential greylisting as a crutch to our existence and as a crutch to how we move forward as a country. I think that is where we would be remiss if we say, Lord, what do I do? We've been greylisted. That's not where we're going to go. Let's do the last bit that I was asked to talk to you about. So there's this thing called the omnibus bill. So what's that? Let's take everything and throw it in one pot and hope to God it works? Because that is what it is. And the question to be asked is, why didn't the Financial Intelligence Center Act work for us when it should have? why didn't the other four pieces of legislation that should form part of this omnibus bill work for us when it should have? Because if you don't understand why it didn't work, putting everything together doesn't make it better. Just makes it a bit more convoluted, makes you scratch your head and think this is something new. All that it has done is it has taken the shortcomings and the shortfalls in previous legislation and it's tweaked it somewhat. The POC de Terre, which is the Terrorism Act, is also being amended. That has to be amended. Because I think as a country, we tend to harbor myths. People like to say that South Africa, we're sort of like a stepping board for terrorists. No, we're not. We will have our own. What do we do with them? We have terror financing. And what is terror financing? There are simple things like, way back in 2015, a teacher in the Western Cape allowed a student, a 15-year-old female student, to use his Absa bank account so she could buy a bus ticket to come to Gauteng so she could get on a plane and join ISIS. It's called terror financing because he is enabling the learner. And so there are these things that we overlook, and all we now have to do is go back and say, what is the legislation we have? What legislation works for us? Beneficial ownership. They've always been trustees. Who are supposed to regulate them? So regardless of which sector you are in, which entity you are in, and you are a beneficial owner, who's supposed to regulate the regulators? Who accounts in terms of accountability? Who takes responsibility for the lots of things that are out there and that we don't get as law enforcement? You know, so everyone loves to get onto the bandwagon. So what will law enforcement do about, what do you want me to do about what? You haven't given me anything. Where's those Section 34 reports that are yours to bring to me? Where are those STRs that should form the basis of the FIC compiling a crime threat analysis that points to a pattern? Who regulates the regulator? Who's going to regulate those trustees? So we broaden the definition. So what? What happens to non-compliance? What happens to the lack of good corporate governance? And so as you sit in this room, if all you do and take away from today is, what are my responsibilities? What am I in terms of legislation, my job description, my work ethic, what is expected of me? And I always say, if you can't be true to self, you can't be true to your calling, you can't be true to country, you'll fail before you start. So I wish you all well in the many endeavors you have. I hope that I always see you on that side of the room and not on this side where prosecutors have you in an accused box. And I don't talk about you as individuals. I talk about your institutions. I talk about the entities. I talk about the companies. So when you go back, not every entity is able to send more than one or two persons. Take the message back. Because in sharing, we're going to learn. In sharing, we're going to implement. And in implementing, we'll pull this country out of what people see as a dark hole that was so captured during the time of state capture. There is no redemption. I have bad news for them. There shall be redemption, and there shall be light, because collectively, absolutely, we are going to be able to pull us out of where we currently are. So I wish FATF well. I wish them well in their deliberations, and I mean that respectfully so. And I wish that they would get to see and really appreciate that those tick boxes that they have to determine whether or not we've done enough changes, and they give us credit for all of the other good things we actually have and actually do, and that the things we do and have doesn't always have to culminate in prosecutions and investigations. I thank you for your attention. I hope you guys have an awesome day. Thank you.
Wow, that was a powerful introduction. I'm sure all of you feel very inspired. I certainly don't feel very grey about being greylisted anymore. But without further ado, I think I'm going to now let my colleague, Lerato Lamola, who's going to facilitate, take care of the rest of the panel proceedings. She's going to introduce our highly esteemed panel as well. And let's see how much more we can learn about this. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. You can hear me now. Great. So I'm going to introduce our panel. Firstly, I'm Lerato Lamola. I'm a member of the financial regulatory team. With me this morning, I have Kim Rue. She's a partner in our dispute resolution team. Joining us all the way from Mauritius, we have Iqbal Rajahbalee. He is the managing partner of BLC Roberts and Associates. This is one of our alliance partner firms. Next to him, we have Kent Davis. He's a partner in our financial regulatory team. And as you all already know, we have Advocate Johnson, who's gracefully agreed to join us as well. Thank you, Advocate Johnson, for that powerful, powerful keynote address. So I think where to start the conversation is just first with an understanding of what is greylisting, right? So as Advocate Johnson indicated, a lot of countries actually hide the fact that they've been greylisted. So currently we have 23 countries in the world which are on the grey list. And as she noted, the United Arab Emirates was recently placed on the list in March this year. But then we also have countries that have successfully come off the list. And Mauritius is one of those. So I'm going to start with Iqbal to just give us a sense of, from the Mauritian experience, what does greylisting actually mean for a country?
Good morning. I'm slightly set back by this question because it sends to me a signal that we are giving perhaps a greater probability of South Africa greylisting as opposed to avoiding it. I'm sorry. I think that we are underestimating tremendously the potentials of South Africa, not only for the work that has been done so far. We've just heard so much from the director of an investigative division. The government has passed in a number of legislation, and perhaps to give you a sense of relativity and context, let's look at Mauritius at this point in time. The context starts with the mutual evaluation report, which came up for South Africa in 2021. In Mauritius at that time, we just said it was an ESAMLAG report, it was an FATF report, so we went to sleep on our two pillows quite comfortably. And it was only like we were greylisted that we actually wake up. Not much was done between the MER, the mutual evaluation report, and the grey listing. So we probably naturally deserve to be on that grey list. But for a country like South Africa, looking at it today, from what I'm hearing and from what I've seen, I think that there's a lot of misinformation, probably, or some exaggeration, probably, coming through either the media or what the business community is sending across as message. I do not understand, and I do not pretend to understand, the internal politics. But I'm just looking at it from an outside point of view. And from an outside point of view, just before coming here, invited by Webber Wentzel, for whom I'm very thankful, to give me this opportunity to address you. It seems to me like everything was wrong. It was doom to go greylisting because nothing is happening. But that's absolutely untrue. The number of legislation is going through. The number of prosecutions is seen and is visible. I'm pretty sure that government would have communicated much more were it not for the confidentiality agreement that it signs with the FATF, which you have to respect, and these are state matters. There are certain things that cannot be disclosed, but I'm pretty sure that there's a lot of things happening. And this is where Mauritius was not at the time it went greylisting. So just to set matters clear, there is nothing that is said and done as yet. What we are talking about, if you would allow me to say, is simply some sort of risk management approach. In case it should happen, what should we be doing? Or what are the measures, the precautionary measures, that we may have to take before that should happen? That's all we're talking about. But certainly, I think to send the signal, and especially from the business community, that South Africa is facing a greylisting or is likely to come into a greylisting, is giving some bad signals to your overseas clients. And that gives them a lot of nervousness and put them in jittery. And it's not your purpose, I suppose, as a service provider to do that. Your purpose is, on the contrary, to reassure them of what you are doing, what the country is doing, what the private sector is doing to avoid and to set matters right where there are deficiencies detected. But broadly speaking, South Africa is standing in good stead. And I suppose that, and that's my own view of things, do like what Webber Wentzel is doing, namely call on your clients, stay close to them. This is an immense opportunity for you to get close to your client and keep them informed on what is happening on the ground, instead of learning from the sensationalist news that appear either on the broadcast or on the media. You are the best person to inform them, and that is what I would suggest we have. Just one last thing, if you would allow me. Mauritius cannot give any lessons to South Africa. Most of the matters that was fixed up during that period of greylisting were provided from competences and skills from South Africa. You have plenty and more of it here. And you should be able, with the proper mindset, with the proper spirit of coordination and cooperation, be able to fix things up as they should. For the rest, we can share experiences, as we will certainly be called upon to do. We will share experiences. We can bounce ideas. But certainly, we all want to set up a financial system that is free from money laundering and corruption. A financial services system internationally that helps, that sustains prosperity and growth and gets out the poverty zone. It's very funny to say, whenever I was coming to South Africa before, and somebody would introduce me as, this is somebody from Mauritius, said, oh Lord, talking about this den of money launderers. And here I am today, coming to be shown as their example to be followed. So if I put a silver line, think about South Africa. If ever it were to be greylisted, coming out of it, you would look as bright as Mauritius is today.
Thank you, Iqbal. And I think you make an important point just listening to you, that greylist, because I think a lot of people don't actually understand what the greylisting designation is, right? It is a designation. It is a reputational risk designation. It is FATF saying that this country has certain deficiencies in its anti-money laundering regime, which may be avenues for anti-money, well, for money laundering or for counter-terrorist financing, right?
May I put it a different way? Yes, I mean, it is not some sort, I mean, it's called a greylist because it is not a blacklist.
Yes.
But certainly, other people will call it differently. And that's the unfortunate label that it brings along with it. Once your country is greylisted by the FATF, European Union tends to look at it automatically as being a blacklisted country, in other words, with a heightened due diligence on any transactions to be done. So is it with the United Kingdom, statutorily speaking, they put it on a schedule, which is called a black schedule to start with. I don't know why that designation. USA is the same thing. But it's got nothing to do. It's just a journey of uplifting, of consolidation, of a system to be put in place to combat money laundering, and we forget. And I'm grateful that the director of investigation division were mentioned earlier on, Ms. Johnson. There is not only money laundering. There is terrorist financing, which is a very important component of this of the program. And the last one is equally important, is the combating of the proliferation of weapon of massive destruction, which we should not underestimate. Mauritius, because of its size, its economy, and whatever, is probably not as exposed to that as a country like South Africa may be. So it would be highly or strongly underlined that we lay stress also on the two other components of what this assessment of the FATF implies. So, yes, we are in constant monitoring by the FATF. This is the methodology by which it works to bring all countries at par in this international fight against money laundering. And Mauritius, even if it is out of the grey list, is still having to make constant reporting to the FATF. But we call it an ordinary monitoring. Whereas, when you're on the grey list, so-called, it is simply an enhanced monitoring by the FATF, in the sense that you have to work closer with the FATF, you've got more reports to be provided just to show what is being achieved. It's exactly like what Mauritius has done before. It receives the report, well, it's just laid on its content feeding that this is a report. No. FATF want to see you in action and constantly updating your legislation and your framework to combat money laundering. And FATF as well, and that's a moving goalpost, which makes it a little bit difficult, keep us very much on our tiptoe all the way through. They are constantly updating their mechanism to fight international money laundering. So while you're being assessed, new recommendations are coming in. New systems which favor money laundering are coming in, which you've got to reckon with. So you are in a perpetual reporting dynamics with the FATF. Mm-hmm. For example, while we were under the grey list, the recommendations on legislation for virtual assets came in. Mm-hmm. And we had to cope with that as well. So it is a tough task. Don't underestimate it. I'm pretty sure the government is taking it very much seriously, as we have just heard. That's just one component of government, and I'm pretty sure the others are there. But the thing, the most important thing, which has been highlighted by Ms. Johnson earlier on, it's the public-private sector collaboration. And if there's anything that the methodology of the FATF would leave us with, and I'm grateful that it does, is there is an effective PPP, a public-private partnership, which would show a very strong will on the part of the nation, on the part of the state, to join the other community at international level to fight money laundering and terrorist financing.
Turning to South Africa, and I'm going to address this one to you, Kent. What can companies expect if South Africa is grey-listed? And now looking more at some of the interventions that South Africa is trying to introduce.
Sure. Thanks, Lerato. So I think maybe as a starting point to just go back to the FATF report. And really, you've spoken about the deficiencies that it highlighted. And you can think about them from a technical perspective. There are technical deficiencies in our legal regime, and there are deficiencies in the effectiveness of our regime. So we've mentioned, you know, Advocate Johnson's mentioned the omnibus bill. And Well, what is that, and what is it? What's contained in there? You know, firstly, you know, it's there to address some technical aspects, some areas in the Financial Intelligence Sector Act and other acts that, you know, needed to be revised, you know, pursuant to deficiencies that have been identified previously. What it also does is it expands on certain concepts, and particularly from a business perspective, one of the areas that it's looking to amend is the laws relating to beneficial ownership. You know, really putting an obligation not only on accountable institutions, but companies, you mentioned trustees and the like, to have a better understanding of who actually has effective control over your businesses. And, you know, this is the one thing that I think when it comes to, well, what should businesses expect as a result of greylisting? These are the type of amendments that, regardless of whether we get greylisted or not, you need to start engaging with today. Both from a sense of, well, these are new laws, how do we go about understanding them? Bearing in mind that the timeline for the implementation of this bill, in order to align ourselves with the FATF review processes, you know, we're looking to pass this in December and in effective in January. But also, as the Advocate Johnson said, is to go back and properly, holistically understand the regime in which you work. Are you actually adopting a risk-based approach to this? What are my compliance obligations? Am I taking this seriously, or am I taking a tick box exercise? And, you know, where we see this is in the way that the private sector has, you know, complied with its various obligations. I mean, just if you look at the suspicious and unusual reporting reports that, you know, accountable institutions, but any business is required to report on. I think 84% of those reports come exclusively from the banks, which means that 16% is coming from the rest of the South African market. That's, you know, that's really, you know, just on a numbers perspective, showing that do you as a business have a proper understanding of your money laundering risks, your terrorist financing risks? And I started this talking about technical compliance, but really the effectiveness is the hard part. And effectiveness is not just to the law enforcement agencies. It's not a case of saying, well, we've put our policy in place, we put it in a drawer, thank you very much, and we'll leave, you know, the MPA to go after the baddies. Really, you need to engage and have an effective system. And with reference to what's happening on the omnibus bill and all of that, that starts today. This is not something we wait for the law to come into effect and we pick it up in January. And, you know, this is here and now. And if we want to get, if we don't, you know, want to avoid this greylisting process, it's a responsibility of everybody in South Africa, including the private sector, and particularly the private sector, to understand its obligations, to effectively implement them, and to engage, you know, with the state in seeing how they can assist.
And I think just on that, you know, so that's the legal, I guess, compliance. But I guess also now turning to you, Kim, looking at the economics of it, because I think that's been where a lot of the media focus has been. What are the potential economic impacts that this potential greylisting could mean?
Yeah, thanks, Lerato. I think if I can sum up the economic impact, probably in two words, not great. And I use the words not great as opposed to words like disaster, doomsday, total destruction. because as Iqbal says, it's called a grey list but it's not a blacklist. Mm. Let's face it, it's also not a whitelist. So we need to bear that in mind. The FATF sanctions impact the financial sector and primarily the international transactions. So one of the biggest impacts, the economic impacts, is the scrutiny that we're going to have on international transactions. Increased due diligence, increased costs of transactions, difficulty in those transactions, possible limitations in some of those transactions, even prohibitions on some particular transactions. There's also the negative reputation that comes with the grey listing. So all of that, as I said, not great. But one thing that we must bear in mind is that grey listing is not a light switch. It's not load shedding. The power doesn't go off immediately. it's a staged impact. once we're grey-listed, it's then a matter of seeing what happens. How do our international counterparts respond to that? What obstacles and hurdles are put in the way? It's not a credit rating, and that's also something to bear in mind. So, as I said, not great, but not a disaster. We need to be ready to deal with that. Kent covered some of the legislation that's going to be coming into force, and that legislation is moving quickly. It's probably the fastest moving legislation that we've seen in the history of South Africa, and it's going to come into effect, and we need to be ready to deal with that. Repeating the words, not great, there's also the other side of the economic impact, and that is the steps that we as a private sector have to take. We need to, Iqbal mentioned, that we need to have that public-private partnership. We need to start taking steps to implement that law. The legislator can put laws in place, but as the private sector, we need to be the ones who actually implement it. Where are our PRECA reports? Where are the reports to the investigative directorate? They can't do anything without those reporting. So the economic impact, we're certainly going to see that impact. We're certainly going to have difficulties with our international transactions. We're going to have increased costs of transactions. And if that grey listing happens, we're going to have to start taking steps and follow the Mauritian example of taking steps quickly to see how quickly we can get out of that grey listing.
Mm. You know, I should just mention that the FATF also has a blacklist. And there are currently three countries that are on the blacklist. So, but again, it is a designation which indicates that that particular country has severe deficiencies in its anti-money laundering regime. And unfortunately, they are not working with the FATF to resolve those deficiencies. So that's what the blacklist means. But again, like we say, you know, it's just unfortunate that that's the names, you know, that they've chosen. But just picking up on your point on public-private partnerships, and I want to go to Advocate Johnson on this one and pick up on something that you said in your speech. How do we rebuild the trust? Because everybody in the ecosystem has to play their part to make this thing work. And there has been a breakdown of trust. So how do we rebuild it?
So I think the rebuilding of the trust is actually in the proof of the work. Mm-hmm. So if you look at law enforcement, there's been a trust deficit for the longest time. Mm-hmm. If you read media articles currently, if the reaction by SCOPA on Thursday was anything to, at least on Wednesday, was anything to go by, sentiment is changing. And sentiment changes because people can see the activities that go with. And there'll always be distrust. But the distrust stems from not collaborating, because we are secretive as law enforcement, we are secretive as the private sector, we are distrusting as the private sector, and as the public sector, we are seen to be complicit. And unless we truly sit around, like we're doing today, and engage, understand the deficiencies, understand the roles and responsibilities, we will have those issues. But I think for me, perhaps most important is when people take ownership and take accountability, you come with trust. You come with credibility. And so you are able to enter a room, own a room, own your story. And so I don't have any magic tricks. I don't have magic answers. There's a motto I've always lived by. My word is my gold. I'm one of those rare prosecutors, I was saying to him this morning. You know, I used to go to court and I would stand up. And I know my witness is not going to pitch up. And I have the worst judge on the planet. And I psych myself up for a tongue-lashing panan, because that's their job. But I always got up and I was always honest. And I would always say why I didn't do what the court expected me to do. And it got to the point where I no longer, and haven't had to, in many years, hand in a piece of paper to substantiate what I'm saying. Mm. And the gist of that is, if you have honesty in what needs to be done, then we're going to overcome that distrust. Mm. Because accept the shortcoming. And the shortcoming that we currently have with the potential grey listing, which I say is not going to happen, and please don't hold me to it when it does happen, because I'm not fat. I think the one way we can really combat that is, what do we show them we're doing from now till then? Mm. So in February is the inspection. Ironically, South Africa will be tested in Morocco.
Mm. Which is on the grey list, by the way. Yes. Morocco is on the grey list.
And I think sometimes, it's exactly what you said. There's, what, 23 countries on the grey list? We actually forget there's worse out there. They don't have what we have. They don't have what it takes. Of course, we have deficiencies. If you take the omnibus bill, it's looking to rectify 14 out of 20. That is no mean feat. Mm. That is true thinking about what we need to do going forward. And if you can correct 14 out of 20 deficiencies, I mean, that is something to brag about. Mm. But the system is unfair. Mm. The evaluation system is not country friendly. It is a one size fits all. Mm. And so the unique ability that Mauritius can see and identify in South Africa, unfortunately, FATF cannot, because it's a one size fits all. But I'm going to ask that going forward, from now till then, these kind of engagements must uplift the country. Mm. Can we uplift one another's abilities, our legislation, our regulations, and a mind shift change that must say to the world, we hear you, and we're going to fix it if there is something to fix. Mm. Or else the grey listing lives on in our minds. And even when it doesn't happen come February, we unfortunately find ourselves wanting as a country, because we've planted that seed that it will happen.
Yeah, definitely.
Can I add something? I think what's also really important to add to that is, we must remember that when our MER was done, when FATF did the mutual evaluation report, we were only, I think, about a third of the way through the Zondo inquiry. Mm. We have come a long way since that report was done. That Zondo inquiry has been completed. We have the reports that are out. It would be nice to see a few more orange jumpsuits and some shackles and chains, but I'll leave that to the advocate to deal with. But we've come a long way, and our prosecutions are happening. Yes, we need to seek some convictions, and I hope that FATF can see that in that period of time, what we've done.
Yeah, definitely. Iqbal?
If I may add to that, and once again, we are looking at the tip of the iceberg. Mm. What is very flashy, what is very visible, what is very astounding, what resonates a lot in the press, with due respect, advocate, the enforcement side should not be in normal circumstances. I can understand the circumstances South Africa is in right now, but it should not be in normal circumstances the touchstone by which the moral health of the country is gauge. Mm. What the message probably I hear it to be is that those ingredients to know the demarcation line between what is adverse to sound commercial life, sound business, as opposed to dishonest business, should be clear. And the system which is being advocated by the FATF is that you take charge and responsibility in your everyday practice of your business. It is not the board, the directors only that should be concerned. Of course, they bear full responsibility. But in the new system of applying the due diligence on clients, this responsibility is devolved down to the front desk. It's the front officer, what you would call, or what I used to call, the clericals at the counter, should, in his or her everyday transaction practice, dealings with clients, should be aware of the risk of money laundering, the risk of its own services being abused by money launderers and for corruption purposes. Mm. It's a frontline responsibility now. Of course, there are various other lines of safeguards that the company would have to establish, and this is something that probably you will be discussing with your lawyers like Lerato and Webber Wentzel. It's extremely important that there is an internal definition of the policy that each and every organization is going to establish to be able to identify the method by which you do the risk rating of your own client. Right now, I understand that there is some updating in the National Risk Assessment Report of the government of South Africa, of the state of South Africa. There are risk rating that is being done at each level of the regulated bodies. The SARB has been doing it. The financial conduct regulator has been doing it. And it is expected that the legal profession authority, whatever it is called, is supposed to be doing it to understand what this line of business, this segment of business, is exposed to in terms of money laundering and corruption. Mm-hmm. So it's getting embedded in our day-to-day commercial and business practices or professional practices, this whole idea that money laundering is a serious risk to sustainability of business. Mm. And it should be like something that is done every day. It's only in those extreme cases where having missed out on all the opportunities that you've been given to redress the situation, you do not do so, that you end up with Advocate Johnson. And then you have been warned.
Yeah. And I think you bring up a very important point. It's all businesses. I think sometimes we fall into the trap thinking that it's just financial sector type businesses that have this AML. No, it's all businesses that could potentially be used for corruption, anti-money laundering, or terrorist financing. So at this stage, as Advocate Johnson indicated, this is meant to be an interactive discussion. So I am going to open the floor to questions. What I would ask is, if you do have a question for the panel, if you'd please just introduce yourself and just indicate which organization you're coming from. There should be a floating mic. Yes, there is a floating mic. So if you do have a question, we've got a question over here. The gentleman in the black suit was quick, or is it blue?
Good morning. I thought I was the fourth person to raise the hand, but I can't see everyone behind me. My name is Walter. I'm from EY. So when I look at some of the requirements from FATF, it looks like it's things that are like you're supposed to do. Mm. Right. So obviously I took the point, Advocate, about, you know, the dangers of a one-size-fits-all approach. And, you know, you can't do that in anything, you know. There are different nuances to it. And I wanted to find out, are there any unreasonable requirements that you believe that the South Africa, it's not really necessary for us to do, that we're seeing in this type of assessments or what you're finding in this type of conversation? So I wanted to find out, anything unreasonable, basically? Thanks.
If you could take that one.
So nothing is unreasonable. I think what actually helps is it gives us a wake-up call, because all that these questions did is it said, you have all of this legislation, you have regulations, you have processes and systems, and you have persons in positions. You err by not doing the following things. And what it does is it makes us aware of what our true responsibilities are. So I don't think anything is unreasonable. I think the expectation of where we should be without taking into account all of the other things over and beyond prosecutions is the shortcoming of the assessment. Because I think when we're preparing the report, someone says they want numbers, they want stats. That's how they measure what you've done. And I'm saying, a discussion like today should say to FATF, We are listening. Your questions are relevant. So these, unfortunately, are not the kind of things they look at. And I think in the engagements with them, it is saying you need to ask the questions you ask, but your evaluation must be different, because the criteria of evaluation is the one size fits all. But the questions are reasonable. They are.
Question. Okay, you've got it.
Thank you so much, sir. Good morning. My name is Mahluleli from Investec Private Bank. I think my question is going to be directed to the advocate, Mrs. Johnson. And I know that you've obviously just touched on quite a lot of great feats that have been achieved, obviously, within your space. And I believe quite a lot of great work being done as well within maybe the SIU, the FIC, and other related bodies. From my limited experience with law enforcement, especially more especially on SAPS level, on that level, I think I've had a very great dissatisfaction in just the level of maybe one, information and competence just around financial crimes particularly. And I know that obviously the higher you go, especially with your kind of bodies, you'd expect that the right kind of skill set and the knowledge will obviously be there richly so. But how can we better, you know, empower, especially, you know, the SAPS, particularly at that level, because I think most of the dissatisfaction and mistrust from private sector towards law enforcement is directed to that particular space as far as law enforcement is concerned, yeah. Thank you.
So unfortunately with law enforcement, it's not just the dissatisfaction in terms of financial crimes. I think over the past few years, there has been great distrust and dissatisfaction, some of it quite legitimate, some of it over-exaggerated. Financial crimes are not something people like. You know, I always tell people, I'm a true blood and guts girl. You give me a postmortem, you give me a weapon, Bob's your uncle, I'm gone to court. And then you give me these leverage files, and then there's these forensic reports, and these 236 documents that come with the bank statements, and there's this thing from the FIC, and what do you want me to do with all of that? Am I supposed to make head and tail of that? And so you must know that there isn't an affinity in law enforcement. There hasn't been. And I think there hasn't been because people don't want to say, I don't know how. Mm-hmm. What has happened in terms of collaboration now in the past few months is we are able to openly talk about, okay, DPCI, what don't you have that the ID can give you? So what we've actually done is, yes, the ID has cases that she takes in her space. The DPCI and the Specialized Commercial Crime Unit have cases they take in their space. We've come up with a hybrid model. So Madam ID says to the DPCI, you've got investigators and you've got policing powers, but I have better legislation. So here's what we're going to do. I'm taking your stuff. I'm going to authorize it in terms of Section 28 in my space. So you get to use my legal tools. You get to use my easier method of working, and I give you prosecutors. And we are trying that. So what it means is we're trying to put out there that financial crimes, especially with the money laundering and the corruption, shouldn't be daunting. If we apply our collective minds, there's actually a way to deal with it. I think the shortcoming you will continue to find is we always talk about these high-level crimes, and we forget that the detectives had a division that looks at fraud and commercial matters. And I think what we've got to do is we've got to get down to that level, because that is the entry level. Mm-hmm. That is where a lot of the money laundering that ought to have been identified in really run-of-the-mill crimes that happen on any given day, mm-hmm. and not just in large corporates, but smaller attorney firms, smaller businesses, are not readily identified. And I think that is where we've got to close the skills gap and the ability of them to identify them. But what we've done as the NPA is we've said it's not advocates only who must look for money laundering. We now have a system where We've come up with, they call it a pro forma, you know, those things where we ask all the younger ones, don't get frightened, just fill in the blanks. So we ask them at the lower court to put these forms in all of their matters, so at the screening process, they already know what to look for to identify money laundering. What that then means is we do prosecution-guided investigations, and our lower-level prosecutors would then be able to write in the investigation diary what those detectives must look for us to be able to consider money laundering and to prosecute it. It's not foolproof, but I think that's a step in the right direction. Mm.
Definitely. I see a hand at the back, the lady in the white jacket.
Hi, thanks very much. My name's Annabelle Bishop. I'm from Investec Bank Limited. I wanted to ask a question, please, on whistleblowers, especially what protection and support is offered to them, and what more needs to be done. You know, in your view, and I'm not sure exactly who to address it to in the panel, but I think certainly, really, you know, we've seen some terrible cases, some terrible outcomes for whistleblowers in South Africa, particularly around state capture and corruption. And, you know, there clearly does need to be a lot more support, and to make it a lot easier. It's difficult to make it anonymous if it goes to court in the crime, but I do feel that that is certainly one stumbling block that we have.
Kent, do you want to try?
Yeah, so I think I'll give it a go. I think that, you know, this is a nice example of distinguishing between what does our legal regime have, what are the protections that are afforded to whistleblowers in terms of the Protected Disclosures Act and, you know, other pieces of legislation, versus how does that play out in the real world? What are witnesses, you know, what is the actual protection being afforded to them? So the legal regime around it may be relatively well established. It gives whistleblowers the necessary legal protection they have from, protecting their disclosures. But I think perhaps what you're talking to is, notwithstanding, there's still, you know, risks, physical risks. I mean, we've seen whistleblowers, you know, as recently as this week, being assassinated for coming forward. And I think in that environment, you know, it's all well and good to say, well, you've got this lovely law that says X, Y, and Z, but whistleblowers are going to be reluctant to come forward unless they have those actual hard guarantees around protecting them and being able to ensure that they can get from the disclosure to a successful prosecution and then obviously continue with life thereafter. So, you know, I think that's from a legal perspective, the regime is there. It's really around how do we practically make sure that those whistleblowers are protected.
Advocate Johnson, do you want to add?
Unfortunately, television has made witness protection and whistleblower protection look sexy. It isn't. And unfortunately, as a country, we don't have, and we didn't have, which is something we're reviewing. People think that if you go into witness protection because you were a whistleblower, you get to change your name, you get to live in a nice house, and we set you up for a job. That's not the reality. So we have the legislation, of course we do. But the whistleblowers are really an issue. And it is something that I think we met Cynthia Stimple about a month back, Cindy, and I had an engagement with her. She's our first true, really true definition of a whistleblower. But when we look at the whistleblowing, where law enforcement has an issue, it's not about protecting, it's about first testing what is given to us. A lot of the so-called whistleblowers, guys, and because you don't get to apply the test, you don't get to test the fact, a lot of them have a lot to hide. So it's a matter of, okay, who goes first, me or you? And then I'm quickly going to hot-foot it to law enforcement and make a protected disclosure. We have to first test the disclosure in terms of authenticity and whether or not it can be corroborated. But once it has, we have a shortcoming in how we deal with the whistleblowers. So the legislation has been reviewed, and I think there's a few tweaks that are being made. What I undertook as the investigating director, and I cannot talk for the rest of law enforcement, is we're going to have our engagements with the whistleblower house, because they have really good initiatives that we can actually take on board and operationalize and see how best we can protect them. Also internally, we've made sure that as we take matters, we've asked prosecutors and investigators across the board to first identify our potential whistleblowers so that we already know that certain measures would have to be put in place to take care of them, both physically, emotionally, and any other way that so requires. So it is work in progress. It is slow. It is really painfully slow, because I think it's for the first time that we publicize our whistleblowers and that there's a bit more comfort in people coming forward, as was the case this week with someone who was whistleblowing in the police since 2009. And then you have the commissioner or the minister of police saying, well, come to my office and talk to me about it. And nothing happened. And so the person comes out now again and says, no one's taking me seriously here in the Free State. I really need you to take care of me. And those measures, unfortunately, fall within the hands of the accusers more often than not, and especially in law enforcement where parties were seen to be complicit. So we have to look at it somewhat differently than we have previously, but it is a true game changer. But the true test is value in what is being given to us. Is it really whistleblowing? Is it a CYA exercise because Johnson wants to cover her ass and so she gets to law enforcement first? Or is it really a protected disclosure and not someone who should actually be a suspect or an accused? So when we go through all of that, we can then decide what steps we need to take.
Thank you. So I'm looking at the time. We've reached our cap. However, if I can request that, so our panel will still be here afterwards. I just want to respect everybody's time. But before I close the panel, I want to give each speaker a chance just to give a closing remark. But our panel will still be here afterwards if you have any questions. Kim, can I start with you?
Yes, sure. Thanks, Laura. So I think in closing, and if I can just follow on from what Advocate Johnson said on the whistleblowing, I think that's where the public private partnership is going to be really important. And I think there's a lot that corporates can do in enhancing their own internal whistleblowing systems. So in other words, making whistleblowing internally an easier option for employees, and assisting the public sector from weeding out some of those whistleblowings that perhaps don't need to be taken all the way, or they're not true whistleblowing, and just making it easier, making it a more of a viable option for people within the workplace and the private sector.
Iqbal?
Thank you. I think the most important point to underline is that the government and the government institutions have long started their work and their journey into establishing the proper legal and institutional framework to meet challenges on the risk, on the anti-money laundering risk. The private sector, I don't think, has done much so far. And when I'm saying private sector, I'm talking about the operators. I think all the financial intermediaries, banks, insurance companies, asset managers and so on, legal profession, should start developing their internal compliance policies now and not tomorrow. That work has to start now because it implies a number of things. First of all, to draft, to discuss, to consult internally, consult with the authorities at the same time, what the components of this policy should be and how to go about it. Secondly, is the training of staff. The policies would be absolutely worthless if the staff are not trained to understand, implement, and apply those policies. And thirdly, is to know the mechanism by which each and every one of you would have to relate to the enforcement authorities, in which I include the FIC and your regulatory authorities and supervisors, in terms of reporting mechanism. And fourthly, how your board is grappling with that issue. All these take time. And then don't forget that it's you have the duty now, not tomorrow, not on grey listing, to do proper due diligence and KYC on your clients. And this is not a matter that starts with the new clients that you're going to that are going to come to you. It is also about the existing clients if you have not done so yet. So that's a hefty task indeed. And believe our experience on this one. And you've got a sense of it right now from what you've heard from Advocate Johnson. There will be that eagerness of all the law enforcement agencies to demonstrate the capability in enforcing their legislation. And they would have, and of course it is their duty, it is their state obligation, to come and do some on-site visits on your premises. And you have to be ready for that. If you have shortcomings, it is their duty to point them out to you, discuss with you. But certainly, where deserved, you would be taken to task. There are two levels in which this sanction would take place. Either is simple, but very considerable, administrative penalties, which may hit your bottom line in your accounts, or it may be a referral for your professional sanction, namely disqualification. And worse still, if it is as serious as that, reference for criminal action. So all these are matters to be taken seriously. There's nothing which is abnormal in it. I mean, if you do a simple mistake at home, you get a slap, perhaps at worst, from your parents. But if it is something serious, you deserve higher punishment. But all that I'm saying is that we are now in a state of preparedness. We have to be ready for those inspections. The enforcement authorities are going to come to you. Your work should start in setting up everything that you need to do to be in compliance with the law. And that would also support the state in demonstrating the ability to monitor, to apply, and to maintain this fight against money laundering and terrorist financing.
Kent?
Thanks, Lerato. I think Iqbal's really highlighted the necessity of starting this process today. It's not something that happens upon greylisting or next year. But I think really just I want to emphasize what's key in all of this is how you approach it. It falls within the compliance regime, and I think there's often this tendency to take a tick box approach. But there really needs to be proper engagement as a company, and this isn't isolated just to the financial sector, this is across any industry, of what are our obligations and how do we ensure that we effectively comply with the objects that the legislation wants from us. We are gone past the days of simply asking for an ID book and great, we've done our job. There really needs to be proper engagement, a well thought out understanding of your regime, and if you're in groups, consistent across the group that you're in. This will be challenging, undoubtedly. I think it's forcing a lot of companies to revisit things that perhaps weren't done with the necessary care and diligence that they ought to have been done when we had the FICA amendment bill. But these challenges are not, first of all, insurmountable, and secondly, they're not unique to South Africa. Countries around the world are grappling, how do we deal with beneficial ownership? How do we deal with all these issues? And I think sometimes we do take a very isolationist approach to things. We think we are the only ones going through this. We're not. Let's learn from others, let's take this on board, and let's get this right, because it's a wonderful opportunity, greylisting or not, to remedy a lot of the wrongdoings that we've seen over several years and move forward in a positive light.
The opportunity, because it's important that we have conversations. But I think what we have to do is accept that public-private partnerships collaboration is a non-negotiable. Mm. It has to keep going. And so when we are not grey-listed next year, it doesn't mean we sit on our laurels and go back to doing the inaction we got used to, or just doing things badly. We cannot afford to be mediocre. And so once we get to February, we must be able to adopt a new methodology of how we all self-regulate, how we deal with compliance, how we deal with reporting, and how we elevate those things that actually are risks in our environment. If we do, we develop a methodology that becomes automatic. We develop a method of operation that becomes automatic. It goes back to what I said earlier. If you always do the right thing, you never have to pause and say, what is the right thing in this circumstance? Mm-hmm. And so I think if we change our mindset, we do things differently, we normalize the different, we'll be ready for FATF 6 ways to Sunday whenever they do decide to arrive.
Thank you. Thank you to ladies and gentlemen for joining us, and thank you to our panel. Thank you, everyone.